Hey class, this is the video lecture for Tuesday, April 28th. Hope everybody's doing good. Today we're going to be talking about culture and the media. Thank you guys for the papers. I graded all of them. You guys did a great job. Hope you guys are working good on the, or working together to do the group projects. If you have any questions, please email me. Also, we're going to have a class on Thursday specifically for you to work on group projects. You don't have to join the live session, but you should commit the time period 4:30 through 6 to be meeting with groups. I'm gonna be live via Blackboard as always, and I'm gonna be there the whole class time to answer questions about group projects. Somebody had emailed me about showing an example of the projects, but I can't show you those examples that I showed live because then students would just copy the whole thing. So before I get into the lesson, I have media blogs and I have a couple of memes to show you guys. Let me just share my screen here. First meme, I mean, this kind of picked up when the quarantine first started, but here's a meme about getting tagged in all those push-up challenges. Yeah, I don't know who this lady is. I'm assuming from some reality show, but she's in a bunch of memes. Here's another meme. And moving on, lastly, somebody gave the answers. It says Samantha snitch on the entire class when someone put the quiz answers on the Zoom chat. So I guess they had a quiz and somebody posted all the answers and she snitched on the teacher. Let's watch it.
Professor, yes. Someone gave the quiz answers in the chat.
Hey, Samantha, fuck you.
Professor, yes. Someone gave the...
All right, and here's another meme because we talked about Blockbuster in class earlier this semester. And it just goes back to nostalgia when we were kids and renting movies. I remember this, spending a whole bunch of time trying to pick movies, fighting over movies, the good old days when we could actually go outside. Moving on, media monitors. Okay, from Dexter. All right, for some reason not working. Let me try it again. So Dexter writes, this article talks about the hit documentary series Tiger King. Focuses overly on the spectacle that was Joe Exotica, Carol Baskin feud and fails to show interest in the actual truth and how the creators of the docuseries seem to care less on these stories, on the story the subjects have to tell, and instead care about milking them for all it's worth. Okay, that'd be interesting. I only saw Tiger King about halfway. So I don't know. You guys can look up this article and check for yourself. Let's see the meme that he had. Oh, this is from the Reopen America protest where it says sacrifice the weak. And it's comparing it to Star Wars. Thank you, Dexter. We have a few more here. From Mikard, let's see. He says, I pick a media source that goes into online education company offering unemployed workers thousands of courses to take in order to help them with career planning after the coronavirus and help those in need of a better education. Okay, cool. Yeah, there's a lot of free courses everybody can take over the summer. So people stay busy and stay up to date. I recommend taking a basic HTML coding course if you can find one. That will always help you. Maybe if you like it, you can take a JavaScript course. Java is a pain, though. But yeah, find something. Maybe you can take Excel. Maybe you can take QuickBooks, something to add to your resume. But again, if this is all stressing you out, you don't really need to do anything. You can just chill out and wait till the world gets back to normal, if we're ever going to get back to quote unquote normal. Let's see his meme. Yeah, so Donald Trump went on national TV during his press briefing and said that ways they're looking at to get rid of the coronavirus was ingesting disinfectants, and people have been running amok with the memes. Also, he said that he's going to stop doing these meetings since people are not taking them seriously or not appreciating them. Let's go through some of them. All right, if they load. All right, doesn't look like they're loading, guys. There's so much stuff on this page that it's just freezing my whole computer. Jesus. All right, here we go. All right, this is too much, too many things loading on this page. Thank you, McCard. We're gonna go to the next one. Wrong thing. Let me see here. All right, thank you guys for the media monitors. We're gonna get into the lesson. It's a short lesson, and we're talking about culture. So what is culture? What does culture mean? And when we talk about media, so why did the Migos name their album Culture? What were they trying to say by naming their album title that? You know, they were trying to say that they were the hottest thing right now, and they created a lot of things that we associate with culture. They had the song Bad and Bougie, which was like number one and going crazy on the radio. They created the dab. Well, it wasn't really Migos. It was one of their associates. I forgot his name right now. So culture is often linked to aspects portrayed in all forms of media. And we'll see in this class how we all have different forms of culture and media isn't as affected our culture. It was Flipper the Skipper who created the dab, but he's an associate of Migos. All right, moving on. Often culture is narrowly associated with art, the unique forms of creative expression that give pleasure and set standards about what is true, good, and beautiful. So what are some of the ways the media told us what is good? What are some of the ways the media told us what is beautiful? They have told us that a certain body type is beautiful. They have told us that what careers are good. Remember, I don't know if we did it, looked at garbage men. Garbage men make over $100,000 a year, but because of media portrayal, we think it's a bad job. And they can retire, I think, in 20 years. Culture, however, can be viewed more broadly as the ways in which people live and represent themselves at particular historical times. What are some examples of past cultural and cultures and cultural moments? We look at the 80s movements, we look at the disco era, things like that. We look at the 90s, well, a lot of that style is coming back, and things like that. So in the discussion, I want you guys to tell me, you know, what are some ways that media has told you what is good and influenced your life? And what are some forms of past culture and cultural moments? We're going to see some of that right now. So super interesting. This is Chicano culture from East LA, but it's actually being emulated in Japan. So these people are emulating a culture, the style of the homes or homies or East LA, you know, sort of Mexican culture to their liking in a completely different part of the world, and they're appreciating it. We have culture of sports. Depending on where you're from or what team you grew up with, there's a sports culture. If you're the Mets, you have a culture of losing and hoping to win. If you're the Patriots, you know you're probably, if your sports culture of the Patriots is always winning, except maybe not now that Brady and whatever his name was traded. And the Lakers have their own culture as well, and the Yankees and so forth and so forth. Literature. There's a culture in literature. Harry Potter has infiltrated all forms of culture. You can go to a Harry Potter themed bar that the drink smoke and potion and all this stuff. You can go to a Broadway show. You can go to Universal Disneyland and ride Harry Potter rides. You can do everything you can possibly imagine in the world of Harry Potter for all ages. Religion has a culture. You see people wearing Jewish symbols or not even Jewish. You see people rocking Buddha tattoos and things like that, and they're not even Buddhist because it has a culture and associates with certain type of things. We associate, let's say, for example, Buddhist symbols and scripture with, you know, yogis and free-spirited people, and these people might have those things on their body. Science has a culture. We have these are some limited edition sneakers that mentioned the moon landing. Science has its own culture. We have Bill Nye the Science Guy. We have a whole bunch of things out of space like that that has its own culture in pop society. So another definition of culture: thus, culture may be defined as the symbols of expression that individuals, groups, and societies use to make sense of daily life and to articulate their values. So we all have unique cultures, and oftentimes the media plays a big part of that. So how does the media play a big part in your culture? And I'm going to show you some aspects of my culture. So my culture. So first of all, why do I have this image of Spider-Man wearing Tim's and a chain, Gucci belt, Yankee fitted? Because it's sort of the Bronx, New York idea, and I'm from the Bronx. And I remember when I was traveling, this German guy asked me, "Hey, do you wear Tim's and a Yankee fitted?" And I was just dying laughing because that's what people around the world associate my background with. And I said, yeah, I used to when I was in high school or in college, but I don't wear that anymore. And not everybody from the Bronx wears that. So what's also part of my culture, my heritage. I'm half Puerto Rican, half Ecuadorian. Even though they're both Hispanic, they share a lot of commonalities. They're very, very different. Different foods, different music, different clothing, different attitudes, different landscapes if you go to the country and things like that. And so they're similar, but they're not the same. And your background will influence your culture, the way you grew up, the things you grew up eating, the ways your parents treated you or acted with you. You know, there's a bunch of memes on social media that I die laughing about growing up Hispanic, and things like that. Also, your culture, your customs. You know, we grew up in New York. Our pizza has to be a certain way. We're not going to eat shitty pizza from somewhere else, or we're going to brag about that we have the best pizza. One of the things here that I mentioned, this is a video, is one of my aspects of my culture is called coquito. It's a drink that Puerto Ricans drink for Christmas, and we make it, and everybody has their own recipe and things like that. And that's a unique part of my culture, because I know once we have the coquito time that it's holidays, it's Thanksgiving, it's New Year's, it's Puerto Rico. It can be attributed to like eggnog. And it's interesting because even my Ecuadorian family has their own version called rompompe, but it's completely different. So yeah, my upbringing, the Bronx, New York City, where I'm from, that's all aspects of my culture and influence who I am today and the views that I have today. So let me know in discussion, what's your culture? Do you have a quote-unquote Long Island culture? Is there an Irish culture? Is there an Italian culture? And is it different from what the stereotypes we see in the media, as we've mentioned before? So we look at other aspects of culture. We can look at the Wild West ideal. It's associated with ruggedness. It's, freedom, riding horses, lassoing. And the Wild West ideal is everywhere. There's bars, Marlboro. I went to Haiti and they had a Wild West bar, which was absolutely insane. I couldn't fathom it. Moving on. So the mass media are the cultural industries and the channels of communication that produce and distribute songs, novels, TV shows, newspapers, movies, video games, internet services, and other cultural products to large numbers of people, as we've seen throughout the semester. So when we look at eras, we have oral, written, print, then we have electronic. This is all mass, messages for more than one, lots, and digital. So look how fast. That thing is moving super, super fast. So fears of the new media. Every new media brings fears that it will make the previous one obsolete. They said that radio was going to take over books. TV was going to make radio obsolete. Cable was going to take over broadcast. Internet overall. All these things still exist, as we mentioned before, but they just transform. And culture is translated into all of these forms of media and showed on all these forms of media. So what's next? What's the next form of media? Let me know what you think in the discussion. I think we're at a standstill for now. I don't think anything groundbreaking is going to come, but I think we will see improvements in the internet, such as 5G. No, 5G is not giving you coronavirus. No, 5G is not giving you cancer. Those are all conspiracy theories. Unless, like a regular cell phone tower, your apartment is right below it, but it shouldn't be. So let us know what do you think is coming next for media. Also quantum computing, just computing growing at a level, but I don't know if there's anything new coming out anytime soon. So after all those things, we had radio, film, television, computers, cable, DVD, satellite, cell phone, smartphones, email. And this happened really, really fast. Think about how long it took society to get the printing press, right? Thousands and millions of years. And think how fast from the printing press to computers and all the things. We're going to see a chart here that shows that. So look how long. Hundreds, thousands of years. And then once we get into the 1800s, things are going really fast. So it took them hundreds of years to get the printing press, but it only took less than 100 years to get electronics. And we're not even 100 years into the start of computers, and we have mobile phones that can do everything computer does. And it's only going to get faster and faster. We're going to have AI, self-driving cars, and all that stuff pretty soon. So we look at models of communication. How does culture and the linear model of mass communication play together? So we have to look at the old model, which is the linear model of mass communication. Senders, which are authors, producers, and organizations, transmit messages, programs, texts, images, sounds, and ads through a mass media channel, newspapers, books, magazines, radio, television, internet, to large groups of receivers, readers, viewers, and consumers. In the process, the gatekeepers, these are the news editors, executive producers, and other media managers function as message filters. So when I asked you for the group projects, have gatekeepers tried to limit the new form? So these are the editors, the executive producers, the media managers. Steven Spielberg, when you talk about streaming video. Liar Cohen, if you're talking about music, other music producers. So media gatekeepers make decisions about what messages actually get produced from particular receivers. So for example, if you wanted to be a rap artist, right? You had to go through some form of A&R, record label. And if they liked your music, if they thought that your music was hip at the time, you might get a pass. That model does exist, but it's not as in control. The media producers are not in control of the media as before. Why? The internet eliminated the gatekeeper role to a large extent, although they do exist and they had to adapt. So think about being a rapper, right? The 20-year-ago model. Let's say now, I think I have the new form of music. I'm a little Nas X, whatever. I'm groundbreaking. I'm going to combine rap with country music, whatever. I went to P. Diddy. He doesn't like my stuff. He's a gatekeeper. He can control what comes out. But now I have the internet. Forget P. Diddy. I'm going to put my music on SoundCloud. And people like it. I don't need P. Diddy anymore. Maybe after, you know, the song picks up, he's going to reach out to me like, okay, you got the following. And that's what happens. Now, a lot of music labels and labels that cater to this, all they do is scout the YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify to find what music is gaining popularity through views and try to sign those people. It's interesting to note, do you guys know the app, I'm forgetting the name right now, Shazam, where you hear a song on the radio, but you don't know the name, and you record it. So Shazam was able, the people who have the app were able to determine that the songs that were Shazammed a lot were songs that were in 4 to 6 weeks were going to become really popular. They were going to be hits. So it's interesting. People were getting, okay, this song sounds cool. I want to know what it is. And then it was going to grow like that. So this is the same thing. If you wanted to make a movie, you wanted to write a book, if you wanted to start a radio, a podcast thing, you can all do that online. You don't need to get studios. You don't need to, you know, get the big gatekeepers. You can do it yourself, thanks to computers. So since that old linear model of culture doesn't exist, we have the cultural model. The cultural model doesn't work in the digital age, so the cultural model was developed. And this concept recognizes that individuals bring diverse meanings to messages, given factors and differences such as gender, age, educational level, ethnicity, and occupation. In this model of mass communication, audiences actively affirm, interpret, refashion, or reject the messages and stories that flow through various media channels. So basically what that means is that we can all interpret media messages differently. If some people in the class watch LeBron James videos, they might say, this is garbage, I don't really care for that guy. But if I watch it and my family watches it, because we also share those videos, we're going to be so amused and entertained by it that we're going to watch it probably like 5 times, which I've done. So here's an example. Lady Gaga released her 9-minute music video for the song Telephone in 2010. Fans and critics had very different interpretations of the video. Some saw Gaga as cutting-edge artists pushing boundaries and celebrating alternate lifestyles and the rightful heir to Madonna. Do you think so? I don't know. Others, however, saw the video as tasteless and cruel, making fun of transsexuals and exploiting women, not to mention celebrating the poisoning of an old boyfriend. We're going to watch a little bit of it here. Look at the product placement. There's a lot of product placement in this Gaga video. We're going to skip forward.
Too bad.
All right, guys, you can watch the video's really long. You can watch it on your own time. Pause this, go back to it. And fun fact, Akon was one of the first people to sign Lady Gaga. So shout out to Akon. So selective exposure. Consumers also shape media messages to fit or support their own values and viewpoints. This phenomenon is known as selective exposure. So people typically seek messages and produce meanings that correspond to their own cultural beliefs, values, and interests. What does that mean? It means that, for example, studies have shown that people with political leanings toward the left or the right tend to seek blogs and news outlets that reinforce their pre-existing views. So basically, if I lean toward the left, I'm going to watch MSNBC. If I lean towards the right, I'm going to watch Fox News. And I'm not going to look vice versa. I'm not going to say, hey, I want to see both points of the both viewpoints. I'm just going to watch the one that I believe in and supports my own values. Another way to look at that, I'm only going to pick the hip-hop playlists and stations because I don't care about pop music. I don't care about country music. I don't care about any other music. And I'm not expanding my knowledge of other types of music. When you look at movies, I'm only going to watch one type of movie instead of seeing others. So when we look at culture, we can look at culture as like a pizza. It's not all one thing. There's different types of pizzas, different slices we can try. You can get pepperoni. You can get whatever this sausage or whatever is here. But I want you guys to see a visual representation that culture is very different and will make up different pieces of us. And the pieces might be different depending on who you are and how your upbringing was. Here's a quote from the book. The word media is, after all, a Latin proof of the singular noun medium, meaning an intervening substance to where something is conveyed or transmitted. Television, newspapers, music, movies, magazines, books, billboards, or radio. Broadcast satellites and the internet are all part of the media, and they are all quite capable of either producing worthy products or pandering to society's worst desires, prejudices, and stereotypes. Yes, a lot of stereotypes. When you get to Math 12, you see a lot about that. And media is kind of messed up. Sometimes they do that. I recently saw, I should have looked it up for you guys. Students are not in school, but they're getting expelled because they're doing this racist TikTok thing. It's where you have like a bowl and you have like little cups and it says like, okay, when God created this person and these two white teens, I don't know where they were from, were doing it on black people and they were super racist and they got expelled even though they're not in school. So the evolution of mass media. Most media is not initiated by innovators, but by the social, cultural, political, and economic circumstances at the time. So telegraph. So what does this mean? This means even though telegraph was created, right, it didn't really get going because of the inventor. It got going because of what was going on in society. The Civil War. At the time, the army needed the telegraph to help make it grow, to help win the war, as we saw, and other things like that, radio, to get news and things like that. So telegraph and radio evolved as newly industrialized nations sought to expand their military and economic control and to transmit information more rapidly. So lastly, we're going to learn about media convergence and how this plays into cultural models. So media convergence has two definitions. The first one involves the technological merging of content across different media channels. The magazine articles, radio programs, songs, TV shows, video games, and movies are now available through the internet, a laptop, tablets, to smartphones. So it's no longer that you have a print magazine, a print book. You have a disc, a CD disc, a LP. You have a TV set. No, they're on all devices. So you can do everything. I can be on Spotify on my phone while browsing through Facebook, Instagram, while having Netflix in the background and all this stuff all on one device. And you can look at Amazon.com. They came by selling old-fashioned books, but now they have everything. You can have Amazon Video, Amazon Music. The other way of media, looking at media convergence, is looking at cross-platform convergence. What does this mean? It means when one media company or media production is adapted to different types of outcomes and different types of things. So this is, I'll give you an example. Cable companies, right? You just need cable. You don't need the phone. You don't need the internet. Guess what? They're trying to sell you all three. They always do this. Also, when a movie comes out, it's not just a movie anymore, right? It's not just, okay, I'm going to see Avengers. I'm going to go to the theater and that's it. Call it a day. No. There's toys. There's apps. There's TV specials. I think you have some Marvel. I forgot the name of the show. Shield or whatever it is. There's a lot of things. You have even fast food promotions. So here are the craziest fast food movie tie-ins. I don't know what that is. Men in Black. When Men in Black 3 came out, Baskin Robbins released flavor ice cream. That looks pretty disgusting. We have Star Wars themed burgers. I think this is Burger King? No, Quick. I don't know what that is. That's probably something overseas. We have a Casino Royale, which is James Bond ice cream. We have Captain America-themed cakes and ice creams at Baskin-Robbins. You can't even get ice cream without being sold media production, which is insane. This is the Dark Knight Whopper. I mean, it looks the same. I don't know what makes it. I guess the cheese? I don't know. Wow. We have a Jar Jar Binks Star Wars themed lollipop thing. And what is this? Denny's created a Hobbit themed breakfast, which looks pretty disgusting. And we see these things all the time now, especially with Avengers and such big movies. You go to Taco Bell, you get a cup. You go to McDonald's, you get a cup, or your siblings get a toy that ties into the movie. Oh, I want to see the movie now. So all the old is still around. It's just online and all at once. So what's the problem with everything being online? And I think this has kind of changed a little bit due to subscription models. I think with your generation, you're okay with paying for certain types of media. But my generation, before they had subscription models, we had everything for free. We could download movies for free. We could do torrents, LimeWire, all music for free. I don't know if you guys were in that era as well. I think you're on the cusp of it. So nobody wanted to pay for anything. I'm not going to pay for any music. I'm not going to pay for any movies. Screw that. I remember when Spotify came out, my best friend was telling me for years, you got to get Spotify. I'm like, no, I'm not going to pay $10 a month when I could just go and download all my albums for free. That was a pain. When you download albums, they don't sound good or the link doesn't work. They shut it down. I had websites, they shut down. Finally, I did Spotify and I love it. If they increase Spotify to $20 a month, I would pay. Maybe 30. I'd love Spotify so much and it's so convenient. Especially when you can do offline mode when I'm traveling. The only thing my issue with Spotify is that they don't have mixtapes. So Spotify would be the ultimate app or any of the other apps if they bought like .piff. But because of licensing issues with mixtapes, they can't do that. Same thing with Netflix. Why am I gonna pay $10 when Netflix first came out? Why am I gonna pay $10 for Netflix if I have all these movies and cable stuff on cable, right? Not everybody has Netflix. Everybody has these apps. It's worth the money. And the same thing with New York Times. Why am I going to pay for these articles? You know, once they put a paywall, now you knew the worth. Okay, I have to see these things. Nobody else is reporting these things like I want to read it. So it does work, subscription-based model. So let me know. Do you think our era is, your generation is used to paying for things, or you always wanted media things for free because you had it online? Also, look at textbooks. You guys can get textbooks for free, and I encourage you, you should explore that option since textbooks are so expensive, and maybe you can find something online. So even TV culture, the whole culture of TV has changed. We mentioned this before in the TV section. It's not about, so when I was a kid, Full House was a big thing. They had this thing on ABC called TGIF Friday, and they would play a bunch of cool shows. Everybody would get their popcorn, get their snacks, 8 o'clock, and watch till 10. You had Full House, Step by Step, another family-based show. You had Family Matters, which was Steve Urkel, and you had this crazy show called Dinosaurs. I don't know. I don't think that's the name. It was about a family that dressed as dinosaurs at prehistoric times. So we would gather around TV. So nobody's sitting around at 9 p.m. to watch Full House anymore. You're watching Fuller House, which is on Netflix and is a sequel or is continuing the show without the two Olsen twins, anywhere you want. You can watch it on your iPad. You can watch it online at the DMV. You can watch it in class if you're not paying attention to me when we actually were in the room. And you can watch it at all times. You don't have to wait to 9. That old thing about, you know, watching a season, I think we mentioned that with TV, is gone. I don't have to wait every week to see what's going on. The new season comes out, I'm spending a whole week binging. So, for example, the show that I really like on Netflix, La Casa del Papel, which is Money Heist, came out earlier this month, Friday. I think I even stood up on Sunday to see if it was going to, I'm sorry, Thursday. So that whole weekend, I'm just binging it. And it kind of like, in a way, cheapens it because I've seen it so fast, I want the next episode, but I got to wait a whole year as opposed to spreading it out. What do you guys think about that? Let me know in the discussion. People watch shows that they're watching and they're telling you about it. So social media will ruin shows for you. If you guys were Game of Thrones fans, if you missed an episode and you went on Facebook or Instagram, they ruined it for you. And I hated it. I was traveling when one of the last seasons came out, and I would not, when I missed the episode, one of the season finales, I actually deleted all social media apps until I got good enough Wi-Fi to watch it, because I just went on and I saw somebody mentioned, oh my God, Tyrion. And I was like, forget it. I don't want it to be ruined. Has the show been ruined for you guys because of social media? Let me know. In all these ways and more, media deeply influences our culture. It influences what we wear, what we watch, what we listen to, and sometimes how we behave and act. Two ways to know how media production has deeply influenced our culture is one of the ways is Halloween, right? So it remains to be seen if we're going to have an active Halloween this year due to COVID-19. But if we have Halloween this year, what do you think everybody's going to be dressed up as? Right? Most likely it's going to be Tiger King, because Tiger King is so influential, right? And another way that doesn't really affect here, in Latin America, especially, not all Latin America, certain countries such as Ecuador, on New Year's, what they do is we burn a paper mache sort of piñata thing. It's called an año viejo, which is the old year. And basically what they do is you take some of your old clothes, maybe you have that you'd want to get rid of. So for example, you would take your ex's hat or shirt and you want to like start the new year and you would burn it. So we take these things, we burn it, we put firecrackers, and it signals the new year. But these things have character connotations. So every year it would be something new, whatever the hottest thing. When I went to Ecuador in 2018, the hottest one was Dragon Ball Z, Dragon Ball Super, with the blue hair Goku and blue hair Vegeta. When I was a kid and went to Ecuador for the first time when I was 8 years old, it was a Power Ranger. And every year it's something new. It's based on when Trump was first elected, that was a very popular one. So every year we know what's the most popular media thing. And it's a fun thing. We go to like the fields and we buy them. I remember, I wish I could show you now. There's a photo of me carrying a Shrek donkey and Shrek org, a bunch of these little things. That's how we know. So look out for Halloween. Let me know in discussion, what do you think, besides Tiger King, what do you think this year's media obsession and influencing our culture, media production is going to be? All right, so for the discussion also, I want you to focus on what are some moments in your life where media has impacted your culture. Was it something that you watched on Disney Channel? Was it a cartoon? Was it Power Rangers? Power Rangers deeply influenced my culture as a kid. I had to watch it. I remember they used to have these specials at 8 p.m. and it was like nuts that I had to stay at, like, finish all my homework to watch it. I had to get the toys. I had to be it for Halloween. It was all engrossing, Power Rangers, everything. Did you have something like that growing up? Also, another thing for me, Zelda, Nintendo 64. They even have, Nike has Air Max 97s, Nintendo 64, playing a nostalgia. I've downloaded an emulator just to have Nintendo 64 and Mario and Zelda, Link, whatever, Zelda game on my phone. Let me know. Hope you guys are well, and I'll see some of you on Thursday. If you have questions, have a good one.